So, to continue with the classification of surfaces, here is the statement of the theorem. It has two parts, part A and part B. Every compact connected surface without boundary is homeomorphic to the surface defined by one of the following canonical polygons. The first one is AA inverse. Second one is A1 inverse B1 inverse, A2 inverse B2 inverse, and so on. AG inverse BG inverse. And G is greater than or equal to 1. The third sequence is A1 A1, A2 A2, A3 A3, and so on. AN. N is greater than or equal to 1. So it's a part A. Every surface is one of this. To be sure, what we are putting is every compact, connected, triangulated surface without boundary is one of this. Okay. Triangulated word has to be introduced because that is what we are assuming, but we are, you know, sure of that every surface is triangulable by Radov theorem, which we have not proved, of course. The second part says any two distinct members of this list gives you the surfaces which are non-homeomorphic. When I say distinct members, AA is one single distinct member. In two, there are infinitely many members. Okay, indexed by G greater than or equal to 1. Similarly, in three, there are infinitely many members. Okay, each one of them is different from each one of the other from within this list, or outside. Anything from 2 will be definitely different from anything from 3. But even within 2, if G1 and G2 are different, the corresponding surfaces are different, and so on. That is the meaning of this. Any two members are representing different surfaces. Okay, so this is the complete classification for surfaces without boundary. The canonical polygon listed above are said to be normal form. Okay, once you normalize, the uniqueness comes. That is the whole idea. The rest of this section will be occupied in proving part A of the theorem, which will be achieved in 5 steps. And then giving 3 different proofs of the uniqueness part of B. Uniqueness part is B. Moreover, any two members are different means it's a unique. Each sequence here gives you a unique surface. Beginning with an arbitrary canonical polygon, it may not be in the normal form. What we have to do is, we have to reduce it to a normal form and show that it is one of them. Okay. Clearly, these are canonical polygons. There is nothing to do. They are normal form. So every canonical polygon can be brought down, whatever we want to say. Brought down means what? To one of these. The process of transformation, as we have illustrated last time with AB, A inverse, B inverse, AB, A, B inverse, that kind of transformation, many more, should not change the what? Homeomorphism type of the surface. The homeomorphism type, we should remain within that. Then we are allowed to do whatever we like. Okay, so that is the whole idea. Okay. So we would like to transform to one of the normal form without changing the homeomorphism type of surface defining it. First observe that in 2 and 3, all the vertices are identified to a single point. You should know that one. A inverse, okay, has only 2 points. Okay, A inverse. Okay, in the identification also there are 2 points. Therefore, I am giving out 1. But in 2, A1, A1 inverse, B1 inverse. After identification of these 4 vertices, only take only 4 vertices to begin with. How many vertices will be left in the quotient space? When you say A, okay, A, B are identified, no identified. A inverse, when you identify, the top 2 gets identified with the bottom 2. So there are only 2 surfaces, 2 vertices. When you do B and B inverse, or both of them will get identified again to a single vertex. So similarly, the same vertex will come for A2, B2, A3, B3 inverse also, because the starting point of B1 inverse will be the starting point of A2. So once you have proved it for A1, B1, A1 inverse, B1, G equal to 1, this you get proof for this. Similarly here also, A1, okay, this you know already, as it is one vertex. If the antipodal points are the vertices, they get identified anyway. Similarly, all the ANs will get identified the same. So in the canonical polygon with more than 4 vertices, okay, either we land up in AA inverse, or first thing to achieve is there is really only one vertex left. The class of vertices, identified vertices, in the original thing there may be several, of course. Okay, there will be exactly 2n of them. In the final thing, there must be only 1. So this is the first thing we want to achieve. Our first aim would be to find a reduction process which will ensure that all vertices are identified to single point. One of the simplest things to do is to cancel out a pair of edges, A inverse. Suppose somewhere in between, one edge comes A, and immediately next edge is identified in the opposite direction with this one. So that is like, you have 2 edges like this, okay, they are identified, you fold them like this. So both the edges go into the interior now, and rest of the things will have 2 edges less. So there is no need to have a sequence, part of sequence A inverse, or somewhere C inverse. Okay, so you can cut down both A and A inverse. Okay, so this is the first thing, this is the simplest thing to do. All right. If both A and A inverse occur in this sequence, for some edge A, we call the pair, let us have a name, this A inverse type as type 1 pair. Remember, each A is followed by I somewhere, not necessarily by the way, this definition is somewhere, not necessarily immediate. Okay, A dot dot dot, A inverse comes. That will be a type 1 pair. If A dot 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 A comes, then that will be called type 2. Let us have this name. Okay. While representing a canonical polygon by a picture, instead of the exponent plus minus 1 over the letter, we shall use arrows, because arrows is easier to indicate, that's all, instead of plus minus 1. When you draw a picture, it is letters and arrows. Okay, now the first step is elimination of edges of type 1, which are consecutive. Okay, we will now show that if D has at least 4 edges to begin with, if it's A inverse, what do you do? inverse, it is the first one. We don't do anything. Suppose there are only A inverse species, then you have already come into the canonical list, the normal form. So don't do anything. But suppose there are more vertices, more edges. There are more edges than just two. And one of the pair is like this. Then I would like to get rid of this. Okay. Now if you cancel it out, it will be empty. So then you don't know what to do with that sequence, empty sequence. No coincidence. This itself gives you whatever you wanted. So this is normal form for us. So let us go ahead. Okay. So suppose there are more. So we will now show that if D has at least four edges, then an adjacent pair of type 1 can be eliminated. Okay. Until we end up with case 1. Or there are no adjacent pairs of type 1. Okay. So 33 illustrates this process. So I will tell you. Okay. So I had earlier given an exercise, which I will now explain. I think I should explain it. So why this is true, why this can be done. Namely, you take a half disk. Okay. Take a half disk, take the upper half part of the diameter and the lower half part of the diameter, put opposite arrows on that. Accordingly, you identify. Okay. So the picture that you get, identification after identification, what is it? It is the disk. Right? Instead of dot, the rest of the circle, if it is some convex polygon, what happens is these two edges get eliminated. Okay, how do you get edges? You can just take theta, e power 2 pi I theta if you're writing. Theta going to I theta, that's all. E power I theta, 2 pi I theta going to e power 4 pi I theta. So double the angle. So that will take care of this one. Okay. So the relation may be coded as, now if you want to do computer programming, all that you have to do, suppose a sequence has this form. Up to cyclic order, I can write it as A inverse. All the sequence which is after A inverse is brought to the left. Anything can be written as A inverse, cancel out A inverse and put A, provided A is non-empty. Otherwise, don't cancel. Stop there. So that is the programming. Okay, so that's what I mean by the whole entire thing can be programmed. Okay, very elementary programming. So this is what is happening here, dot, 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 half the disk, the diameter A and A inverse are there, right, in the sequence. A, this will be A inverse, the other way around. So I have taken A inverse this way, in the anti-clockwise. And these are all dot, dot, dots, I don't know what, several of them. So when you identify by taking this one, that one, that square here, what you get is the edge A has gone inside by identifying with itself, right? So this becomes a sequence A now. So that is the canonical polygon. Okay. So we can after the getting this one, you can actually make it into a convex polygon. That part is no problem. So I can always replace a circular disk with a regular convex polygon. Okay. By repeating the application of this, we eliminate all adjacent pairs of type 1 till there are no adjacent pairs of type 1, or we are left with AA inverse. Okay. In the case of A inverse, the process itself is over. So let us assume that there are no adjacent types of pair 1 and the sequence is has more than 4 elements or whatever, or A inverse, at least 2 elements. Okay, so this is one very easily obtained reduction. The second reduction is whatever you wanted, namely getting only one vertex class, okay, single vertex class. How to do that? So we consider the equivalence classes of vertices under the quotient map P to X. Okay, to begin with, we have 2n vertices. Several of them get identified. So we have maybe 1 or 2 or 3 classes. If there is only one class, we are done. If there are 2 or 3 and so on, look at one of the classes with there are more than 2 classes, then only we can. Okay. Consider a class P of vertices with the least number of elements in it. So suppose one class has 6 elements, another class has 8 elements, and so on. Look at the class with the least number of elements. We pick up a vertex P in this class so that the next vertex is Q, okay, which is not in this class. Because there are at least 2 classes, this should happen. Okay, keep going around the class, around the polygon, okay, keep only in the class. The next one is not in the class. You pick up one such. Okay. Let R be the other vertex adjacent to P. P and Q are adjacent because that is how we have chosen. R is the one which is behind on the other side. Okay. Now let A and B denote the edges R to P and P to Q. So here is the diagram. So P was my chosen vertex, Q is the next one, they are in a different class. There must be one vertex behind, let it call as R. So this R to P I have put A, P to Q I have put B. Okay, why? Because this couldn't have been A inverse in any case. Okay, so maybe it is AA. If this is AA, what happens? Then these two vertices would be in the same class. So if Q is in the different class, therefore it's A and B. Okay, how this have to be gone through very meticulously. The rest of them, you don't know. Somewhere this A must have occurred because this is not A. So call that as now. This vertex is R and that vertex is P because they are getting identified. So they are different vertices in the polygon, but I am labeling them because they are getting identified. Okay, and that is A, so this is also A. Okay, with this kind of in dot dot dot, you don't know so many divisions may be there. Okay, somewhere in the polygon there is one such thing like this one. All that you do is cut from R to Q, cut this triangle, mark it as C. Okay, you have to put an arrow here, whichever way you like. So I have put the arrow from Q to R. Okay, the arrow is here. So when I cut it, the remaining thing here is there P R R Q. But this triangle, I am bringing it back here. This side A matching this side A. A and A are matching. A and A have to be identified anyway. So when I identify this, the rest of them is this one. The picture is now very twisted kind of polygon. Doesn't matter. It can be straightened out to become a convex polygon. That part is no problem. This is dot, dot, dot. Okay. then the sea is on this side like this. The direction is very important. So this is sea, dot, dot, dot. So when you take this triangle down here, you, this is A, okay? Behind that, there is a C from Q to this part, okay? And then B is from P to Q. So orient it correctly. What is the sequence you have got? C, dot, 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 C, dot, 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 B. That is the sequence. A is disappeared. That is not what I want. What I want is, how many letters are there? How many vertices are there in the class of P now, in the new one? Okay, can you see that there is some reduction in the number of elements in the class of this vertex P? See, picture, it's very clear. There are 2 points here. Here, there's only one. There may be many more, but those things would have been there in the dot, dot, dot part. The idea is that there were six vertices here, now there will be five. Repeat the same process on this class itself. Okay? This class itself you repeat. Finally, what happens? This class, when there are two of them, it will just disappear. The problem is, what has happened is, when you did this one, you can't repeat this process immediately. One thing has happened, namely, you may get another pair which is of the type C, C inverse, which was not there in this one, but it is there in this one. So step one has to be performed on this one again. When you perform step one, singleton vertices disappear. Sometimes that is what happened. Step one here, this vertex, it has disappeared. Okay, so you have to do again after doing one step like this. Carry on the first step again. Okay, so that ensure that there are no A inverses. Okay, when you do this one, this will not increase the class, increase the class of vertices. Okay, so here you have reduced the one of the classes, number of vertices has reduced. So this step does not increase that. Therefore, this step is valid. And now again, you can assume this one, and now carry on this one on the same class, which has fewer elements. So finally, one of the class itself has disappeared. If there are two classes, now there is only one class. If there are 50,000 classes, now there will be only 50,000 minus one classes. Okay? Now pick up another one, which is the least from there. So by induction, what you do is by combining step one, two, and alternatively, you have to argue step one, step two for performing them. What you get is a canonical polygon, in which all the vertices are identified to a single point. By this, we don't mean that the vertices are identified on their own. No, never. The identification is always taking place from edge to edge. Two edges are being identified each time. Okay? You don't pick up a polygon and identify two of the edges, two of the vertices. That is never done. Okay? So, after this cut and all that, what we have got is the sequence A, B, something here. So, I have written what? A, B, capital A inverse B becomes C inverse A, B, C, B. So this is the operation. So you can computerize this operation. With the corresponding conditions, you carry out like this. If you blindly carrying it out, it may not reduce something. Okay, keep doing this. Again, ask it to do, if there are, if you see AA inverse is, cut down that and so on. Okay. If needed, we carry out step one again. So this has to be done. Note that each time step one is performed, the number of edges as well as the number of vertices goes down without increasing the number of equivalence classes. Step two, on the other hand, keeps all these numbers the same. Okay. By repeated application of these two steps, we keep reducing the number of vertices from the classes with the least number of vertices each time. And hence, at some stage, one of this class has to disappear. The smallest class disappears first. Indeed, if a class of vertices has just one vertex in it, this implies the edge, the two edges incident at this vertex must be of the type 1, AA inverse. There is no other way. Therefore, we perform step 1, the two edges will disappear along with the vertex. So this way, we keep reducing the number of classes themselves until there is only one class left. Okay, thus, from now onwards, we shall assume that all vertices are identified at a single point. It is worth noting that none of the reduction processes, operations that we perform, okay, from now onwards, will disturb this property. There are some other kinds of operations we are bringing, okay, that will never disturb this property. Means what? It will not introduce AA inverses. It will not introduce extra vertex classes. Vertex class will be always one from now on. All right. So next time we shall do the final reduction. Today we will stop here.